People of God, let us stand and be called to worship from the words of Psalm 47. Clap your hands, all people. Shout to God with loud songs of joy. Sing praises to God. Sing praises. Sing praises to our King. Sing praises. Sing praises with a psalm. Turn to number 7 in your worship guide, and this is Psalm 98, set to the tune that's become known as the Cadillac tune around here. And let me just encourage you that this song moves. And so I will be leading from up here. So if you get lost, just look back up here to your pastor. And I can't guarantee that it'll be like a brazen serpent in the wilderness, but eventually you will be saved, okay? And we will get to the end of this psalm together. So let us sing. Oh, sing a new song to the Lord.
Why is right? Before lunch, if we keep going at this pace. Okay, everybody right here. Okay, are you ready? Oh, all the earth shout to the Lord. Here we go.
Oh, all the earth shout to the Lord and make a joyful sound. And make a joyful sound. Lift up your voice so loud.
Let's do it. All right. Starting note, please.
For he shall come, he surely comes, the judge of earth to be, the judge of earth to be. He'll judge the world with righteousness.
Let us pray. Father, we love praising you. We love to sing joyfully to your most holy name. All of the great promises that we have just sung in this psalm, most of which that you are a God of absolute equity. When all seems unfair, when all seems broken around us, we so quickly forget that you are the judge that stands as witness as well, not only to actions, but motives and desires. And Lord, someday you will set all things right in your holy court as you grant us the new heavens and the new earth wherein righteousness dwells. And this morning, today, is just a foretaste of that. As we gather, not as individuals, not merely as families, but Lord, as your family, as your church in this place, to sing praise to you, to hear from your word, to lift up the requests of our hearts to you. Lord, we pray that you would open our eyes to see you fulfilling your covenant promises to us. Help us as we worship you to know the presence and power of your Spirit, to find satisfaction and joy in our crucified and risen Savior, and to find peace in the love of our Heavenly Father. We pray in Christ's name, amen and amen. Please be seated. As we turn now to reflect on God's law, we remember that the law of God first shows us our utter inability to obey our Heavenly Father. And then it shows us the utter ability and accomplishment of Christ to obey God's law for us. And then it serves as a glorious, beautiful rule of life of how we might live thankful lives before our God, already having been forgiven of all the sins that we commit against Him. So we reflect today to see God's work in our lives, but also to discover those things perhaps that we need to confess before our God this morning. So let us reflect on God's law together. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain.
Let your yes be yes and your no be no, so that you may not fall under condemnation.
Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy.
There remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God, for whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works, as God did from his.
Amen. Take a few moments in silence to confess your sins, to fellowship with the Lord, to ask Him for greater strength and power to faithfully obey Him, and to thank Him for the love that He has shown by applying the person and work of Christ to your life by the Holy Spirit. Father, thank you for hearing our confession, for confirming our faith, for reminding us of all that we have in Christ. In His name we pray. Friends, stand with me as we hear the assurance of grace from Micah 7:19. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. Amen? Amen. And as that one great pastor said, He has thrown our sins into the sea, so don't you go fishing. Let us sing as we delight in the grace of our God.
Within me is now and ever shall be.
Amen. Please be seated as Elder Miguel comes to pray the prayer of the church.
Morning. All right, brothers and sisters, please pray with me. You are the living God, and there is no God besides you. You put to death, and you bring to life. You have wounded, and you will heal, and no one can deliver from your hand. We will recall to mind the former things, those of long ago. You are God, and there is no other. You are God, and there is none like you. O God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, we humbly come before you in prayer for renewal. Help us not conform to the ways of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds, so that we might discern and live in accordance with your good, acceptable, and perfect will. Grant upon us a spirit of wisdom and revelation, that we may grow in the full knowledge of him. Illuminate the eyes of our hearts so that we may grasp the hope of your divine calling, the wealth of your glorious inheritance among the saints, and the immeasurable greatness of your power towards us who believe. In humble submission, we approach your throne of grace. In all that we do, may we be mindful of your glory and act as faithful stewards. In managing the time you have granted us, give us the grace to cast aside the deeds of darkness and clothe ourselves in the armor of light during this mortal existence, during which your Son, Jesus Christ, humbly visited us. In the cultivating and application of the gifts you have given, we humbly implore you to grant us the ability to always conduct the task of our calling and all our affairs in agreement with your divine word. In doing so, may we continually prioritize the glory of your name, the expansion of your kingdom, and the fulfillment of your holy will. In the wise stewardship of the wealth you have entrusted, may we not forget that satisfaction derived from wealth is not found in simply possessing it or spending it generously, but rather in applying it wisely. In the preservation and proclamation of the truths you have revealed, grant us your spirit of power so that we may love and profess the truth, standing for righteousness without hesitation, advocating and defending it until our final breath. May we willingly bear any suffering in accordance with your will, without grumbling, and for the purpose of honoring Christ and professing his precious name. Let us not be afraid or avoid any peril. May we consistently uphold a strong testimony, just as our Savior, Christ, did in the presence of Pontius Pilate. In the nurturing and cherishing of our relationships that you have ordained, help us to embody selflessness and humility in all our interactions, whether with relatives, our church family, or neighbors. May we follow the example set by our King Christ Jesus. Through a compassionate and humble demeanor, let us confidently affect those around us, ensuring that your name is continually magnified and praised in every aspect of our lives. By demonstrating our commitment to you, not only do we strengthen our relationships, but we also move others to follow in your footsteps. And in the attendance of the preaching and teaching of your word, grant upon this congregation, O Lord, your spirit and heavenly wisdom, so that your word may flourish and grow among us, joyfully proclaimed as it ought to be through our pastors, and that this sacred assembly may be enriched through it. In all these things, we're unable to commit ourselves faithfully to, but we know that you are the one who gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might increases the strength. Even youths shall faint and be weary, and young men shall be exhausted. But they who wait for you shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Therefore, grant us patience, so that we may honor and glorify you in all this. May we serve you in unyielding faith and remain unwavering in professing your name until the end. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one true God, forever and ever. Amen.
As we prepare for the preaching of the word, let us stand together and sing, "Speak, O Lord, the words are there for you in the bulletin." Stay standing and turn with me to the book of Acts, chapter 1. Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 8, as we listen to the word read this morning. Acts chapter 1, starting in verse 6, let us hear God's word to us today. So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, and in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth." The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God stands forever. Amen. Please be seated. What a challenging chorus to sing. in that previous hymn, asking the Lord to test us by his word. This is the true measure of our lives, is the place and priority of God's word in our lives and to us. God has been so faithful to stoop down and give us the scriptures so that we might know him and to learn and to grow in Christ. This is a text that I'm sure many of you, if you grew up in church, are familiar with. If you grew up in a church that has a little bit more emphasis on the liturgical year, on the Sunday of Pentecost, this was probably a text that was read regularly in the context in which you worshiped. Even if you did not grow up in a church that used the ecclesiastical calendar, you're familiar with this moment of promise of Christ, this promise of power, the Holy Spirit coming upon his people. And as we begin today, you know, we're always so hard on the disciples. It's so easy to, you know, Monday morning quarterback how they should have responded, how they should have interacted with everything going on around them. And we see here in verse 6 that they came together, they asked the Lord, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" Now they ask this in what Luke gives us in just the verse prior, where Jesus promises that just as John baptized with water, he would baptize them with the Holy Spirit. And so first, what we come to in verses 6 through 8 is short-sighted disciples. The disciples here were simply trying to apply Christ's teachings to them. But they were short-sighted in how they were doing it. Jesus had taught them about the Spirit. We just referenced verse 5 above. Verses 4 and 5 say, "And while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, 'You heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now.'" And so Jesus had taught them about the Holy Spirit. He had also taught them about the kingdom, as we see in the verse just prior to this, the verse that we focused on at Easter. He presented himself alive to them after his suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. Remember, he spent those 40 days living with them. They hung out at the beach, they had a fish fry, they ate, they fellowshipped, but Jesus was teaching them, talking to them about the kingdom. And we know from Luke's testimony elsewhere that Jesus taught them from the scriptures. We see potential summaries of this teaching in apostolic sermons in Acts 2, Acts 7, Acts 13. But back in Luke chapter 24, we find, in beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Later in that same chapter, verse 44, "Then he said to them, 'These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled.'" In fact, maybe he turned to Psalm 98 and talked to them about his return and his sitting in judgment in perfect equity over the nations of the world. But we want to remember that we don't know everything that Jesus said and did. And we actually truncate, we cut short our discipleship when we treat God's word as if we have every little thing that Jesus said and did. In fact, we have probably just a small portion of what Jesus said and did in those over 3 years that he was on the earth. In fact, you might see this difference in those of you who are maybe in your 70s and 80s. The number of pictures and recordings and mementos you have of your children, that would stand opposed to those of you who are in your 30s and 40s, how many pictures and videos and mementos. We act as if the cell phone of the church is full of everything that Jesus said and did. But in reality, we have a few snapshots, a few recordings, just a little bit of what our Savior said and did. We've reminded ourselves a few times of John 21, 25. Now there are also many other things that Jesus did. Were every one of them to be written, I suppose that a laptop itself could not contain the books that would be written. Oh, he said world, but you know how much you can fit on a laptop. And you know when it's time to get a laptop, when the old one fills up, you just go get a new one and start filling it up with everything that you want to keep. But we have been given everything we need. We haven't been given everything, but we've been given everything we need to know him, to partake of the divine nature, to escape the corruption of sinful desire in the world. Peter reminds us of this. May grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, so that through them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sinful desire. Now, those of you who approach life in an exhaustive way, it's exhausting for your spouse, but you think, I need to know as much as I possibly can. I need to know every option. I need to know every jot and tittle. God has not given you that. There is a lot we don't know, but we have everything that we need to know, and might I submit that we don't really even know that yet. Jesus had linked his own ministry to the coming of the Spirit. And the eschatological hope, that's a big fancy word meaning end of time, end of the world, hope that he would comfort and restore his people. Remember when he went to the synagogue that day, and Luke testifies to this in chapter 4 of his gospel, Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And that was simply Jesus doing a cover of Isaiah 61, where the prophet said, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant to those who mourn in Zion, to give them a beautiful headdress instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit, that they may be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified." Now, some of you might be like one of my kids, who I recently played a cover of a song for that I really love. And he listened to, sorry, Jonathan, that one child listened to it and said, "Yeah, this is really good." but I prefer the original. But friends, when you hear Jesus' cover of Isaiah 61 and Luke 4, you don't prefer the original. You prefer Jesus stepping into that reality and saying, I'm here. I'm the one that the prophet promised. I'm the one upon whom the Spirit has landed. I am the one who will set free the captives. I'm the one who will anoint your head with oil. I'm the one who will comfort you and bring you peace. And Jesus here is just simply emphasizing the running theme of Isaiah. This comfort that Christ would bring to his people. A quick survey. Isaiah 40, verse 1, comfort, comfort my people, says our God. 40, verse 9, go on up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift up, fear not, say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Chapter 41, 27, I was the first to say to Zion, behold, here they are, and I give to Jerusalem a herald of good news. 49:13, sing for joy, O heavens, and exult, O earth. Break forth, O mountains, into singing. For the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his afflicted. Isaiah 51:3, for the Lord comforts Zion. He comforts all her waste places and makes her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. 51:12, I am he who comforts you. You, who are you that you are afraid of man who dies, the son of man who is made like grass? 52:7, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him who brings good news, who publishes peace, who brings good news of happiness, who publishes salvation, who says to Zion, your God reigns. 52:9, break forth together into singing, you waste places of Jerusalem, for the Lord has comforted his people. He has redeemed Jerusalem. 54:11, O afflicted one, storm-tossed and not comforted, behold, I will set your stones in antimony and lay your foundations with sapphires. 57:18, I have seen his ways, but I will heal him. I will lead him and restore comfort to him and to his mourners. Chapter 60, verse 6, a multitude of camels shall cover you. That's a good thing. Okay, sorry. In our day and age, we might need to clarify that. A multitude of camels shall cover you. The young camels of Midian and Ephah, all those from Sheba shall come. They shall bring gold and frankincense and shall bring good news, the praises of the Lord. Last one, 66, verse 13. As one whom his mother comforts, so I will comfort you. You shall be comforted in Jerusalem. And I know not all of us maybe had good relationships with our mothers, but the comfort of any parent or parent-type figure who holds us and comforts us in our deepest points of need and hurting, that is what Jesus does. As he comes, he brings comfort and peace. And the Spirit of God being poured out upon him points us to the Spirit of God being poured out on us as he promises to restore his people. That's what the disciples are asking about. But secondly, we see a sovereign daytimer. A sovereign daytimer. He said to them, it is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. See, the disciples' timing was off. There would be a kingdom restored, but Christ had to suffer first. Other things needed to happen. Luke again testifies in chapter 9 of his gospel, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and on the third day be raised. Some of us don't like it when we don't know what's going on. We want to know the schedule. We want to know the timeline. We want to know what's happening. We want to know where our place is in it. But far from unnerving, this not knowing the finer points of Christ's timelines, we can have confidence that our sovereign, provident, all-loving God has set these timelines. We're reminded of this in Psalm 139. When we are told, in your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. What a different perspective on life. We know that we were formed, but we imagine ourselves being presented to this endless timeline that's so much bigger and grander than we are, and we are subservient to it. God reminds us, yes, we were formed, but our days were formed for us to live in the love and the power of Christ. God has set the timelines, and we can find comfort in that. And it's especially comforting when we remember that the final book of the Scriptures is the revelation of Jesus Christ, not the publishing of end times timelines. Every word of Scripture should point us to this one who is the very glory of Him who has written down every one of our days in His book. Thirdly, we see spirit descension. The Spirit descending, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. Here, the promise of the Spirit, which we saw last time that Jesus was able to make and able to fulfill as the Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. This promise brings with it a benefit, some of which we saw also last time. Here, Jesus is saying that this promised Spirit will bring power. The Greek here is dunamin. Perhaps you've heard that this word means, in the words of that great theologian, J.J. Walker, dynamite. And while explanations like that might seem like, well, good times, I'll give all of you boomers a moment to bask in that. That's not what it means. It does mean power, but more the power of ability. It's not as exciting, perhaps, but just as meaningful as it is a promise from our Savior. It's this moment that we see a little bit of the old covenant, new covenant, or old dispensation, new dispensation of the covenant of grace. In seeing this promise that Jesus makes about the Spirit, we confess in chapter 7 of our confession that this covenant, God's covenant with man, was differently administered in the time of the law and in the time of the gospel. Under the law, it was administered by promises, prophecies, sacrifices, circumcision, the Paschal Lamb, and other types and ordinances delivered to the people of the Jews, all for signifying Christ to come, which were for that time sufficient and effective through the operation of the Spirit to instruct and build up the elect in faith in the promised Messiah, by whom they had full remission of sins and eternal salvation, and is called the Old Testament. The next paragraph says, under the gospel, when Christ the substance was exhibited, the ordinances in which this covenant is dispensed are the preaching of the word and the administration of the sacraments of baptism and the Lord's Supper, which though fewer in number and administered with more simplicity
and less outward glory, yet in them it is held forth in more fullness, evidence, and spiritual efficiency to all nations, both Jews and Gentiles, and is called the New Testament. There are not therefore two covenants of grace differing in substance, but one and the same under various dispensations. What is that saying? That's saying that it's always been Jesus. But in the Old Testament, there were types, there were shadows, there were ceremonies, there were sacrifices, there were all these things that were going on pointing forward to the promised Messiah. And all of that was sufficient to preach the good news to the elect, that they could understand the Messiah to come and be saved. Now, in the New Testament, in the gospel era of the covenant of grace, we have much more simple ceremonies that point us back to that one who came. And part of the difference between these dispensations of the covenant of grace is the understanding of the Spirit and what He does in the life of the believer. Just like it's always been Jesus, it's always also been the Holy Spirit who has taken the things of the promised one and applied them to the believer. That was true in Abraham's day. That was true in Moses' day. That was true in David's day. That was true in Malachi's day. And now in the New Testament, we see that more fully. Here, Jesus is making explicit that descension, that coming down of the Spirit upon the believer, starting with the apostles, which is absolutely necessary to the conversion and sanctification of the one who follows Jesus. So, when David prays in Psalm 51, do not cast me away from your presence. Don't take your Holy Spirit from me. That's not saying that believers could lose the Holy Spirit in the Old Testament, but I think probably each and every one of us knows what it means to lose the fellowship of the Holy Spirit when we have delighted in sin. We can easily feel as if the Spirit is being taken from us. And that, my friends, should scare us to death. And it should cause us to quickly return to our Savior. The fourth thing that we see is spiritual dominion. Why will the Spirit come down giving power to the believer? And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. You will be my witnesses. The actual word there is martyr, and witness is what the word martyr means. But martyr has come to mean someone who dies for their witness. But that's not the base meaning of the word. So we'll say that we're witnesses, because if I tell you all you have the Spirit and that means you're a martyr, I want you to come back next Sunday too. And so we want to speak with clarity. Martyrs, witnesses, are faithful witnesses to a historic event. And indeed, whether it was Peter in Jerusalem, or Paul in Rome, or Thomas in India, these men stood as witnesses to the resurrected Christ. The disciples asked a question, and they got their answer. Jesus would restore the kingdom to Israel, but not a geopolitical kingdom as we might think of it, but it is a kingdom. But it's not a kingdom of those who are singularly Jewish, but it is to be a kingdom of the Israel of God. The spiritual descendants of Abraham, made of every tribe, nation, kindred, and tongue. A kingdom that will not be shaken. We read in Hebrews 12, therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Romans 9, for not all who are descended from Israel belong to Israel, and not all are children of Abraham because they are his offspring. But through Isaac shall your offspring be named. This means that it is not the children of the flesh who are the children of God, but the children of the promise who are counted as offspring. Revelation 5, verses 9 and 10, and they sang a new song, saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth. And then two chapters later, Revelation 7, verses 9 and 10. After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. Jesus has promised to all believers that we will receive a promised worldwide movement. The Holy Spirit will come upon us, and as a consequence, we will be able to do all that He asks of us, to spread the gospel from our door to the farthest dune, or as the title of an old missions text says, from Jerusalem to Irian Jaya. Friends, we as God's people have been given His Spirit, the purpose of which is to have power to be His witnesses. This is the work that is before us. We are a worshiping body, but we are also a witnessing body, and we have power to do so. Stand with me as we pray. Father, we thank you for your promises that have come through your Son. Promises that He is able to make and to keep. And we take great joy and delight in this promise, a promise we will see fulfilled in the weeks to come, that the Holy Spirit would come, that He would fall down upon these apostles, and they would be empowered to be witnesses to the ends of the earth. Father, thank you that we stand in that stream, that we as believers are granted your Holy Spirit to convince us of our sin and misery and to make us able to receive Christ as He has given to us in the gospel. We pray that each one today would have or will do that as your Spirit works among us. We pray in Christ's name. And church, let us pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Turn in your hymnal to number 246 as we prepare to come to the table and sing Man of Sorrows, What a Name.
Sorrows, what a name for the lifted up was he to die. It is finished, was his cry. Now in heaven it's all clear, hallelujah, what a Savior. When he comes our glorious King, all his ransom going to bring, then anew this song we'll sing, hallelujah, what a Savior.
Christian, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. That is the fundamental confession of Christians everywhere, that we believe in each of these things, in the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. We believe in the church. We believe in baptism. We believe in the forgiveness of sins. We believe the Lord is coming again. And friend, for each one who not only says they believe that, but has also participated in the aspects of that, being baptized, being united to the church, professing their faith, living in repentance, living in the forgiveness of those sins. Christ has given this sacrament, this means of grace that communicates to us all that he has given to us and done for us in his death, his broken body and shed blood. The Apostle Paul reminds us in 1 Corinthians 11, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" And so as Christ did on that day, we also see the bread torn, being reminded of that sacrifice that Christ would make. And we see the cup before us, a reminder of his blood that was shed for us, the blood of that new covenant. And Paul goes on, "Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself." And so, friends, as we come to this moment, we want to remember that from the beginning of the service, we've been preparing our hearts. We have reflected on God's law. We have confessed our sins. We've been reminded of the grace of Jesus Christ. We have heard the word preached that this sacrament confirms. We can't have the sacrament without the word.
because the word is where we find the sacrament. The word is where we find the communication of what's being communicated to us in the sacrament, in word, the broken body and the shed blood of our Lord. And it's up to us to do due diligence to examine ourselves. So whether you're in your 90s or you are 9 or even a little younger, if you are one who has been examined by the elders and been given entrance to the table, it is still upon you to reflect on your life, on what Christ is doing, on how you might walk closer with Him, and doing that under that sweet blanket of grace, knowing that it's not in our doing, but it's in our receiving, that empty hand of faith, that we receive all that Christ has given us. Let us pray. Father, we praise you and bless you now as we come to the table of our Lord. This simple meal that you have given us through Christ, to not merely remember what he has done, but to actually commune with him as he is here by the presence of your Holy Spirit. Father, we pray that you would set apart as much of this bread as is eaten and this cup as is drunk from a common to a sacramental use for the building up of your saints in the most holy faith. Father, thank you for strengthening our weak knees. Thank you for helping us stand in the grace that is ours in Jesus Christ. And not only to stand, but to walk and be fed and be nourished by him. We pray these names, pray these things by the name and for the sake of Jesus Christ, the church's only King and head. Amen. Brothers, if you would come and let us prepare to serve God's people. The center sections, if you would come down the center aisle, grab the bread and the cup, return to your seat, we'll partake together. Outer sections, out the outer aisles, and return down the middle aisles. People of God, stand. Let us come. Let us feast together at the table of our Lord. Thank you. Jesus said, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat." Let us eat together. Jesus said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us drink together. Amen. Stand with me as we pray. Father, our minds echo with the words of that song that was played, "The reason we live is to worship you." And Father, that is true every hour of every day, but we are so thankful for your day that you have given us to gather and to worship together and to receive from your hand such good gifts. We thank you for our Savior. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that fills us, that empowers us to live lives of witnesses to that historic event of the death, burial, and resurrection of our Savior Jesus. We thank you that he has met with us today, and that by your Holy Spirit, he is fulfilling his covenant promises to us. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's praise our God as we sing the doxology. To stay, enjoy some coffee as you head up to 204 for the home class, or back into here in the sanctuary for the "Who Are We" class. If you forget that, this might be the class for you. If you haven't gotten your steps in this week, you can go down to the fellowship hall for coffee as well. And there are some tables there if you need to sit to fellowship for a few moments before you get back to your higher ed class or take your kids off to their Sunday school classes. And then we warmly invite you back tonight at 5 o'clock for evening worship. Aaron will be leading the worship service. I'll be preaching and talking about the Dirty Dozen. So come back. It should be a real shoot 'em up sermon. And we would love to have you to end the day and worship together. Now at the close of this Lord's Day morning, receive the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.